Let's get down to business and start actually doing some coding and doing some work with the browser instead of just talking about the browser. So that is the topic of today. We will focus on DOM and we will focus on events. So now a question to all of you in the lecture room. Have you been working with event-driven programming? Some of you have, some of you have not. I guess that you who are program students have worked with event-driven programming, and maybe not all of you who are taking the course as a freestanding course. So I will give you an introduction because it's nothing strange really, but could be might be confusing in the beginning. And if you haven't noticed, JavaScript is vastly different from Java and C Sharp, for instance, in the functional way the program is that JavaScript is built. We have those prototypes, we have the prototypal inheritance, we have the function, higher order functions, so we can take functions and send to other functions and return functions. We have closures and different kind of concepts that we are not used to. Another big difference between Java and JavaScript is that JavaScript is single-threaded, whereas Java is multi-threaded. So we don't have, this is a truth with a modification maybe. There are some kind of multi-threading going on in JavaScript as well. We will get to that, but thinking about it right now, we should think of JavaScript as single-threaded. We have one single thread executing, and if you do stuff in the thread that locks the program from executing, the whole browser will more or less freeze. So we need to be able to know that that is the situation and how to handle it. And we have something called an event loop that we will discuss, and the event loop I think is essential to be able to get how this event-driven model is working in JavaScript. So we will focus on the event loop today as well. So two parts. First part, the DOM, the API against the HTML document, the API in the browser that we as JavaScript developers can use to manipulate web pages. And the event-driven nature, how to react on stuff that the user does or things that the browser does. How can we react and how can we act upon those events? So first of all, the DOM. The code to the right is quite obvious to you now. It's a simple HTML document. It's so simple I've omitted the lang and the meta tag and the doc type, or I could say that the doc type is there, I just didn't show it on the slide. We could say it like that. So this is quite a simple HTML document with an H1 element, a P element containing an A element, and so on. This is translated into a tree structure that is called a DOM, and the DOM is the API that we could access this HTML code via. So to the left, you have the tree representation of this exact document. And it's quite, I mean, shouldn't be that hard to follow. At the top, we have something that we haven't seen yet. It's the document object. And the document object is the mother node of the whole HTML document. It could be the one could argue that it should be the HTML tags, but or the HTML element, but it is not. And remember, for instance, we have the doc type before the HTML element. So we have this upper document object that we will use a lot. I've tried to color code everything in this lecture so it will be easier to get. So the yellow are HTML elements, the purple is built-in JavaScript objects, and the blue ones are text nodes. So if we look at this document, we see that we have the upper HTML element that contains everything. The HTML element contains the head and the body, and the head contains the title of the page, and the title has a text node inside of it. And in the same way, the body has three children, the H1, the P, and the P, and those elements have child elements as well. And we finish off by, in the A element, also having a text node. Yeah.
So they are all child nodes for the HTML?
Yeah, so child nodes are the ones that are directly under a node. So in this case, the H1, P, and P are child nodes of the body. The A is a child node of the P, and the image is a child node of the P.
Same time body to the...
Yeah, so the body and the head are children to the HTML. Yeah. So that is basically a picture you need to have in mind all the time. However, it will not be this easy. Could anyone spot something that is missing in this picture? That is actually in the code to the right, but I haven't marked it to the left. Yeah, the new lines and the tabs. The problem is, we will jump to this one right ahead. When you write code, you add a lot of text nodes without thinking of it. You add like a new line and a tab or two spaces or whatever between all of those elements. And you should. You should write beautiful code that is easy to read. But by doing that, by indenting our code, we are also adding a lot of text nodes. So, for instance, this HTML element, the first child of the HTML element is actually a text node containing a backslash n and a backslash t, in this case. So I said that the HTML node had two children, head and body, but actually it has five. So it has an empty text node, it has a head, an empty text node, a body, and an empty text node. And this could be cumbersome sometimes. It could be hard to do certain stuff if you don't use the right API methods. Back in the days, this were a real pain in the ass because Internet Explorer ignored empty nodes. So Internet Explorer actually didn't present those empty text nodes in the API. Whereas the standard and Firefox and Netscape and everybody else presented them. So if you were using Internet Explorer and you tried to find out the number of children in the HTML, you would get 2 in Internet Explorer and you would get 5 in Firefox. And you can imagine the problems stemming from that. We don't have those problems anymore. Since all browsers has come together and are using the standard, so this is what we have today. But as I said before, Microsoft always had some kind of good intent. They said, oh, no one cares about those. Let's just skip them. Everybody wants to get rid of them anyway. But the standard didn't. But we have new API calls for those situations, and I will show them to you. So back to my representation of the color coding in this one. We have a lot of like 10 or 12 or something like that different node types inside of the browser or in the DOM, but we will focus on probably the upper two, the elements being H1s, P's, A's, div, section, nav, all of those elements that they are used to working with. And we have the text nodes as well, which is text inside all those blank lines. Comments get their own type of nodes, and so does the document, the upper document node. This one, the upper document node, we will use that a lot. But when you get a hold of an element using JavaScript, you can use something called a node value to find out if this is an element node or if this is a text node. And this was the thing you had to do before to be able to filter out empty text nodes, for instance, in some browsers. We don't need to do that anymore, but it's good to know that we have a lot of different nodes, but we will be focusing on element and text nodes. Once again.
Can I call element node as a tag node?
Can I call, you mean if you could say that it is a tag node? Mm-hmm. I will try to call them element nodes. But they are tags, yeah. In HTML we often call them tags, but this, it's the whole element. It's the element. And you will find inside of this element you have references to its children. So that's why we call them elements and not tags. So the first thing we need to know to be able to program against this is how to basically navigate through those nodes. Okay, say that you are in the H1 and you want to go to the P or whatever. How do we navigate in this tree structure? And we have properties for doing so. So say that we have, okay, so this is a parent node. It could be the HTML node or whatever. And this parent node has three underlying nodes, or elements, I should say, in this case, because they are yellow. We have no text elements in this case, but I will talk a little bit about that as well. I mean, there could be text elements before and between those nodes as well, but we ignore that for now. So this node has three child nodes, and those are represented in something called a node list. And a node list, you can see it as an array, more or less. It's not an array, but it's an array-ish collection. So if we have a reference to this node in JavaScript, we could write dot first child and get to this one. So we have a reference to this node, we write dot first child and we get a reference to this node. However, we have two separate API calls. We have the first child, which is the one that has been there forever, and we have a newer one called first element child. So this is important because if you're using first child and the first child is a text node, like in this example, if I call first child on the HTML element, I will get the empty text node. But if I instead use the first element child, then I will get the head. So, and those are newer, so you have to watch out with compatibility, but I think it's okay now. I think it's like IE8 or something that won't support those. So I think it's quite okay. So try to always use those first element child. They are a little bit longer, but they will only give you the elements, not the text nodes. The same manner, all nodes have a parent node, except the document node that has null as its parent node. So you can walk the opposite direction. In this case, you don't need parent element node because a text object can never be a parent. So a parent node is always an element node. You can walk among the siblings by using next element sibling and previous element sibling. You can omit the element keyword, but then you will get the text nodes as well, if there are any. You could write this node dot child nodes, and then you will get a collection of all the child nodes, or you can use the newer one, children, that will give you only the elements, not the text nodes. Okay? So this is how you navigate. Of course, you could do stuff like this. Okay, I need to do something with this image down here. Okay, we get a document dot first element child dot last element child dot last element child dot first element child, and then you get the image. I mean, you could do that, and you will get a reference to this image. What is bad with that approach? Yeah, you will have to traverse a lot if the tree gets big, and it's really prone to errors when it comes to changing the tree. I mean, if you add another p tag, it will break, basically. You won't hit that tag anymore. So using those API calls, you are usually using one, maybe two at a time. Like, okay, I really need to find the first child of the body. Okay, then you can use that one. A better approach is to use more or less the same approach as you have used in CSS. I mean, you could in CSS write those long, okay, it should be an image inside a P that inside the body, and you style it. But basically, you would probably like set a class on the P tag or an ID on this P tag, get that element, and then find the first image element inside of that element. So that's a better approach to name those nodes using classes or IDs. And when we have done that, we could use some of those. Yep. Yeah, exactly. We have tools like, I'm repeating for the mic, we have tools like ad blocking or other tools or plugins to the browser that manipulates the DOM. They will go in and change this as well. So if you are reliant on a structure, it could change. And I mean, it's not just ad blocking stuff. I'm using LastPass for password handling and in it in search code in into the page. So yeah, but it will use the browser will use this API as well when you're writing plugin. And there are actually ways of listening to changes in the document as well, so you can could act upon changes if another program or a plugin is changing the DOM. You can act upon it and find out what was changed, but we'll get to that after the break. So instead of using those, you will use them a bit, not very much. We will probably use this more, but I will show an even neater way soon. So those, the two upper ones, get element by ID and get element by tag name, those are API calls that has been here forever as well. And those are, I mean, get element by ID is more or less a legendary API call in the browser because it's been there forever and it's been used a lot. What it does is you write document.getElementById, and as an argument to get element by ID, you send a string containing the ID of the node you want to fetch. How many identical IDs can you have on the same page? How many ID equals main could you have on the same page? Only one for you who did the exam. We had that as one question, and now I spoiled it for the rest of you. Yeah.
As I see here, we are kind of working with IDs in JavaScript, but as I remember, you told us we should avoid to work with IDs.
So you can only have one ID on one page. And that is important because if you add two, I mean, this API call will get you one node. You won't get two. You won't get an array of nodes. You will get one node. In CSS, if you used IDs, you could probably change all of them, even if you have multiple with the same ID. But in JavaScript, you will get, I think, the last one. I said that, okay, maybe you won't work with IDs so much. You will, in some cases, maybe an ID is ideal for, like, say you have 12 blog posts rendered. You could have an ID that is unique for every blog post, which is a number that is your key in the database or whatever, just to be able to know when you are doing stuff with this one, which it corresponds to in the database maybe. But often I find that I don't use IDs a lot. I use classes a lot more. And that is because we get a good synergy with the using classes and together with CSS as well. Because the API for working with classes on elements in the DOM is bit better than using it for IDs, because IDs, you can't do much with IDs. You can remove them or add them, but with classes you can toggle and add and remove, and you can do a lot more. So that's why I tend to use classes more. But I want to show you those because you will see them a lot. Get the element by ID is probably one of the more used API calls out there when it comes to working with the DOM. We also have the get elements by tag name. Note that it sets elements. So this will give you a node list back. You will get more than one element. If there are only one, for instance, body on your page, and you write get elements by class name body, you will get a list with one item, or a list with zero items if there are none. But the get element by ID will return an element, and the get elements by tag name and get elements by class name will return node lists. You have an example down below. So of course, get elements by class name will give you all elements that has the class defined set. And if you have multiple classes, like you have avatar and post, you have those two CSS classes set on the element. If you do a get elements by class name avatar, you will get this element even though it has several classes. So just if it's in the list of classes, you will get it by the get elements by class name. However, we can forget all about this. This is for, I would say this is for historical reasons, because I tend to always write a capital D in ID for some reason, and it will break my code. I forget the elements when I should have a tag name, and so on and so on. A far better way of working with this is using the new selectors API. I say new, and that's because I've been teaching this for so long. It's not new anymore. It was new like 6 or 7 years ago. Today it has a good support in all browsers, and the selectors API uses CSS selectors. So that's why I was so keen on CSS selectors a couple of weeks ago, because it will all come back right now. So what this selector does is it allows us to write a CSS selector and get the element using the CSS selector. And the selectors API or CSS selectors are quite rich. You know, we could have like this, a direct child of. So we could fine tune those selectors really, really well. This was, if we go back a couple of years in time, or 5 or 6, this was a big selling point for jQuery. This was, I mean, you always used jQuery, and you often used it to be able to have a selectors API, because it wasn't built into JavaScript, or JavaScript in the browser. But now it is built into the DOM, and we can use it, and should use it, I think. So, let's see an example. Okay, we want a div. We want to find the div that has the ID main, and we could just write document.query selector main, and this will give us a reference to that div tag. In the same way that if we wrote this in a CSS selector, we will get a reference, the CSS will get a reference to that div tag, and all the code, the CSS code you write, will affect that div tag. In this case, we get a reference main div that references this node, and now we can start working on that node using JavaScript. If we want to get all the elements on the page, we could use the query selector all. Query selector all returns a node list. Query selector returns one. And if this will get a hit on several, you will only get one, and I think you get the last one, if I'm not mistaken. Could be. And in this case down below, we say that, okay, find all p tags with a class set to tag. So you just write your selector code inside of the string, and JavaScript will do this, the rest for you. And I would guess that behind the curtains, the selectors API is using the exactly same code base as a CSS is using, or the browser engine is using when it's setting up CSS and the selectors in CSS. So I guess you get quite a good performance out of this as well. Yeah, in the last, all p tags or all p elements with a class set to tag. If I had a white space between, it will be all elements inside of the p tag which has the class set to tag. So it's, yeah, it's exactly the same as when we talked about selectors for CSS. You can. If you want to learn one thing about getting hold of elements using JavaScript, the selectors API is it. And it's those two methods you need to know. You can, if you like, you can forget about this. But if you tend to work in the business, you will run into those API calls quite a lot because they are common. Yeah, I said that query selector returns a node element, and the query selector all returns a node list. And the problem with the node lists, it's an array-like data structure. But the problem with the node list is that it is not an array. The node list prototype is not equal to the arrays prototype. And that means that some of the methods and iterator functions that we have on arrays are not available on the node list, and this is really irritating. Because if you say that you get those three children, the H1, the P, and the P, then you will probably do something with each one of those. You could, of course, iterate them using a for loop. Just like usually you find out the length of the node list, and you iterate using I, and so on. Just like a normal array, but we don't want to use that. We want to use for each, and we want to use reduce, and we want to use filter and map and all of those new iterator functions. But they are functions on the array prototype and not on the node list prototype. So we can't, or can we? Actually, and this is where the dynamic part of JavaScript comes in, that I mean, we have higher order functions. We can copy reference to functions and make them act on other objects. So one thing of doing this is the first one, and note it's an anti-pattern, so don't do this, but you could. So what we do is we just write the node list dot prototype dot for each. So we create a new property called for each on the node list prototype, and we assign it to the arrays prototype for each. So we take the reference to the for each method on the array and adds it to the node list. And now, voila, the node list has the for each method. And now we could use for each on the node list, and it will work perfectly. We just need to add that line of code in the beginning of our program, and then we could use for each on every node list in the application. Why is that an anti-pattern?
You overwrite something in
prototype. Yeah, you're enhancing the built-in prototypes. It's okay to do this with the prototypal language. The problem is the node list is a built-in type. and we are extending the built-in type. Someday in the future, there will be maybe a for each on the node list element, but we will override it. So we will override the built-in for each somewhere in the future. Okay, of course, we could have some kind of test to check if the for each is set, and if it's not, we add it. That's a better way of doing it. But you should probably not mess with the built-in types at all. You should just leave them as they are, even though you can do stuff on them. So you're free to do this if you like. Just beware of the consequences. A better way is borrowing methods, and this is something you can do in JavaScript as well. We can borrow the method instead when we need to use it. So okay, say we need the for each loop on the node list. We can do it like this. Like, start up by this line of code. No, that one. The first one. So what are we doing? We are calling the method for each, but instead of just having the parentheses after the for each, we are using a method that is built in on all objects that is called call. So we are basically saying that call this function. The first one is what scope should the function have. So we say call for each on the nodes, the node list. And the second and third and fourth argument and so on is the arguments sent into for each. And for each wants iterator function. So the second argument is the iterator function that will give us each node, and we can do something with it. And this is just a shorter way of doing the same thing using arrow functions. So instead of needing to write function, node, and curly brackets, we could just write node and the arrow and the curly brackets. So that's a shorter way of doing it. This is a much better way of borrowing methods in JavaScript instead of changing or altering the built-in type. You could also, I'm not sure I recommend it, but you could. This is a pattern you will find sometimes. You could make the node list into an array using the slice method. So you use the slice method on the array, and you send in the node list, and out you will get a new array. And now it's an array, and when it's an array, you have the for each. I would recommend the middle one. I think it's the most common one that you will see. So when you're using node list and you want to use the iterator functions, know that you can borrow functions from other types. And this, for someone programming in Java, this could look quite strange, but we can actually borrow functions from whatever type we like. However, it's important that the function we borrow is somewhat compatible with our type of object. It turns out that for each is compatible with a node list. Otherwise it wouldn't work. So if we try to do for each on a node, we will get an error probably, because it's not an iteratable element, or type, I should say. Okay, that one could be quite confusing. Yep.
When you do this kind of stuff, like, you need to have some kind of protocol for the node list, right? It must support something.
Yeah. Yeah, what I just said, that it must be compatible in some way. Yeah. So what this does when I run call is that it sets this inside of for each to nodes. So for each must be written in mind that this refers to some kind of list or iteratable stuff, but you don't have like an interface or something like that that tells you that this is okay or this is not okay. You will have to try basically, and if it works, it works. If it don't, they are not compatible.
Okay.
I don't think so, no. I don't think that you can see that in the documentation in that way. I'm not sure though. In this case, I mean,
Yeah, in this case, it's
yeah.
obvious maybe the
Yeah,
bottleneck is
because
the
this is
user.
done so often because node lists, you use them all the time.
Yeah,
But,
any both are
yeah.
horrible, but.
But I mean, you can write an own type that is a person list. And you can use the same thing. If the person list has properties that you could iterate over, and it will probably have that. You could probably, if you for each on an object, I'm not sure if you will iterate over the properties on the object, maybe, even. I'm not sure. You have to try that, but it's quite versatile often. But sometimes it won't work at all, of course, because they are not compatible in any way, and you might get an unexpected result, maybe even. But I don't think you have like in the documentation that said, okay, so this type is iteratable, so you can use for each or map or reduce. You'll have to find out for yourself. But you have the computer, so look it up. Thanks. I forgot to say, if you who are listening on live coding, you're free to ask questions, and John will forward them to me. Okay, so that is the node list and iteration and getting the right node. The next thing we want to do, if we have selected a node, the next thing we want to be able to do is to manipulate the nodes, like moving it in the tree, arranging it in different orders, removing it completely, adding new elements. That's a quite common use case that you need to add stuff. Think of it like, okay, you have this form you're supposed to fill out, and you have three rows of children. For instance, you should write your children, and you have four children. So when you have written the third one, you should probably add a new row for the fourth children, for the fourth child and fifth child. I talk about real children now. So we have a form, and me as a parent are supposed to fill it out with my children's name. And if I have more than three children, the code on the page should probably add new fields dynamically. If I had 25 children, it would be horrendous if the form was hard-coded into 25, because that's the maximum number of children a person have in Sweden or something like that. So it should be able to grow, of course. And this is manipulation in the DOM. How to move, insert, delete, copy nodes in the DOM. And I will show you two ways as well. The first one is quite not so convenient, but it's good to have it in your toolbox, and then I should show you a better way of doing it, okay? So we could add nodes. When we have API calls for all of those, I will just go over them really quickly. So adding nodes, we do it by node. If we have a node, we do an append child with a new node. So we have a reference to a new node, and we have the node that we have selected, and we do append child, and it will add it to the children's list at the end of the children's list. So append child will add a child. Insert before, we could use insert before if we need to insert it between two child objects. We don't want to put it last. We could use insert before. Then we need the node to insert it before. So we need a reference to that node, and we will insert it before that node. We can replace nodes, we can remove nodes, and we can make clone of nodes. The clone node will take true or false, and if we clone a node with true, it will make a deep copy of all children and all their children and so on. So we will get a deep copy. False, we only get a node without any content. Yep.
Sorry, I'm lost. The nodes were created in HTML, right?
Yeah, I will get to. So think of in some magical way we have a reference to a node. We don't know how to create it yet, and this node is a node I have selected in the HTML document. So say that we have a reference to this UL, for instance, and we have named it UL. Then we could write UL dot append child, and as an argument to append child, we could just put in a new node, and it will come after the last list element. But we need to know how to create those as well. We could, of course, I don't think we could append an existing node. What will happen then? I've never done that. Not sure why you should. No. But think we need a way to create those nodes. We will have a look at that. So it's quite easy. You have a function on the document that says create element. It will create you a new element. And you just tell that function call as an argument what element you want to create. So this will create a new p tag or p element. So create element, it's that simple. If you want to create a text node, you do a create text node and with some text. So in this case, we created a new p element and a new text node. Then I take the new text node and I append it to the p element. So now we have a p element containing a text. And then I, on the document, use the query selector to find my main div, and I append the new p element into the div. When I do that, the browser will flag sort of the DOM for re-rendering. Because by doing this, we are manipulating what the user should see. The first three lines doesn't affect the user, right? Because we are just creating stuff in the background. They are not visible yet to the user. But by doing the last line, we are telling the browser that, okay, we are ready to re-render the page. And this takes a lot of effort for the browser. It's a slow operation to re-render the page. The browser engine must render, parse the HTML, and see if it needs to reflow stuff using the CSS engine. And so this takes some time. Won't be noticeable by the user, but if you do stuff like this, for instance, in a loop, you just keep adding a lot of stuff in a loop, it could be that it will be slow in some instances. Now the browser will not issue the re-rendering until this code has been run, but so it will add several stuff, probably several elements at the same time. Okay, but creating text nodes and creating element nodes is quite simple. There are some shortcuts. I will show them quickly. If you want to create a text node, you can use, or if you have an element, you can use the text content property and add the text. And this will create a text node and add it to the element. Or it will replace everything inside the element and add the text node, I should say. So if the element has children, those children will be wiped, and you will only have the text inside the text, the element after this. The inner HTML was developed by Microsoft. It's a shorthand for adding elements, basically. So instead of creating those using create element, adding appending childs and stuff, you could do this. If we do element.innerHTML, we are replacing everything inside element with a new p element containing some text. So the p element will be created, inserted into the DOM, and so will the text. There are some security issues with this, though. So injecting code via strings are often not a good idea. You could maybe get some JavaScript in this string and that JavaScript will eventually run in the user's browser. So there are some security concerns using in HTML. A good rule of thumb is always to try to use the text content and not use the inner HTML. We will see better ways of doing this stuff down here. Let's say, if we are writing code like this, what are we doing? Yeah, we are mixing HTML and JavaScript inside a JavaScript file, right? And I wanted to separate those. Actually, this is also mixing HTML and JavaScript because we are creating HTML code inside of the JavaScript. I don't like that either. Let's see. I need to just quickly. You know we have attributes on nodes. Of course, you can work with those attributes. You can add attributes, you can remove attributes. And you have the get attribute, the set attribute, and remove attribute. So it's quite a simple API, this as well. And you have an example down below. So we create an image. We set a new attribute on the image called source. And we set it to an image like that. When we then append this image to the document and our code returns, the browser will render this image tag. And when it renders the image element, image tag, it will see that it has an URL and it will send a request to the URL getting the picture. So this will trigger a network request doing this. But it will trigger first when our code have returned, done its work. So this is basically an easy way to dynamically add images to our page. So if we do this, say 10 seconds after the user entered our page, then the image will load after 10 seconds.
So what's the difference in this and the one we did before, create nodes?
Yeah, so in this one, we are only creating nodes without, if we do an image tag like this, it doesn't have a source attribute, so the browser will not fetch an image. We need to add the attribute. Of course, you could do it within our HTML and just writing the image source blah, 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 as a string. But once again, you should not probably. So we have the set attribute, get attribute, and remove attribute. We have a special API for working with styles. This was not in the standard, but it's really commonly used. And that is by using the style property on the node. So if we do something like this, we take a node and dot style color and add a color, the result will be this. So the node was the P element. But when we did this, we added style color to the P element. However, as you can see, the ones taking or doing the CSS standard was probably not developers, for no developer will ever think about adding dashes to properties, because that won't work in nearly any language. But in CSS, we have dashes inside of property names. So we have the font dash size, for instance. If you were to write node.style.font-style, this will be interpreted as a minus or a subtraction. So it would try to subtract size from node style color font. Wouldn't make sense. So when we're using those CSS, some special CSS properties in JavaScript, we need to camel case the property names. There are some that are, we have the float property, for instance, in CSS. We can't use float in JavaScript. Float is a reserved language. So you need to use CSS float. This is just quirks you need to learn. But once again, I don't think this is a good way of writing code. Because what are you doing? You are writing CSS code inside a JavaScript, and you should not. So there are some edge cases when you need to do this. If you're dynamically, if you want to animate the color using CSS, like it should animate from yellow to red to blue using JavaScript, you will probably need to do something like this in a loop or timed loop. If you need to drag and drop stuff and you need to write that code for yourself, you need to probably to alter the X and Y properties of the element so it will change on the page. But just setting a color like this, you should never do that. If you want to change the color later on, you need to go into the JavaScript, finding this row, and change the color. Of course, that should be in the JavaScript, in the CSS. So you could just go into the CSS and change the color there. How do we do that? Well, yeah, this is the example I said. If you want to move something, you can use the top and left and add pixels and stuff to animate it. We should separate, but the better way of doing this is using classes. So once again, classes come to the rescue. So look at the upper code. We select a node on the page. We doesn't matter what node. It's called discovery. So we select the node, and then we have an attribute called classList on all nodes, or element nodes. And we could just add a class to that element. Adding that class will make the browser add the CSS that is connected to this class to the element the regular way, just like if you wrote JS changed in the HTML code from the beginning. And then in the CSS code, we could have something like this. We have the class JS changed, and we set the color there instead. Now we separate it. Now we have the JavaScript for itself, the HTML for itself, and the CSS for itself. And this class list has some good properties, or methods, I should say. We have the add, which are adding a class. So if you already had whatever, we were adding a new class. We have the remove, that will remove that class, but only that class, not all of the classes. And this is important because you will find out that you will have several classes set on one element. And you don't want to take into account what other classes are set. You just need to focus on your class. You can do that by toggle, and that one is really, really, really good to use. And that's also a jQuery stuff, I think. When I used jQuery, anyways, that was something I used a lot. You just toggle a class. This is like if you want to say you have, once again, you have a form, and you have some kind of way of just clicking a list, and the form will animate up, and you click the list again, and it will animate down. So you can open and close the form like this. Then you could just toggle with JavaScript. When you click, you toggle the CSS class, and whoop, and it will animate using CSS. And you click again, you toggle it, and it will animate using CSS. So you basically need one line of code in JavaScript, and then you can put the rest in the CSS, how the animation time should hold, how long the animation time should be, if it should be some transparency and stuff. You just add it into the CSS. You don't need to have it in the JavaScript. And you can ask if the class list contains a class as well. Okay. Yep.
So make node.classList.add. So we just add this class attribute in, maybe it has several classes, we just add one more class.
Yeah, you just add it in the end. Okay. Yeah. So the ones already there are unchanged. It's not set, it's add.
Okay, so now whatever it will affect only
that P element, yeah.
Not the more P elements?
No, not just this one. You're adding the class to this one, so this one is the one that will be changed. That's right. Okay, before the break. A simple one. This is, I mean, you can all look at this code, yes, and you see the HTML3 in front of you, right? You have the P, and you have the UL, and you have the LEs inside the P, and you have, no problem, right? It's easy code to read. Or? You look terrified. Of course, this is not good. Okay, so we have, we're creating a P. We're adding post to the class list of P. So we have a P with a post class. And when we create an UL and a list and a list, and inside of the first list, we add the class active. So the first list has the class active. And then we create an A element, and we set the A element to this href. And then we create a text, the first link. We append the text into the A1. It's a hazard to read this code. What are we doing here? We are mixing HTML and CSS, HTML into JavaScript. This is not, if I see code like this, it's, no, don't do it. There are better ways. Here, this is the code that we were looking at. If we look inside the template tags, we see the P class post, we have a UL, we have a list active. This is easier to read, right? This is no problem to understand. So we have something called templates. This is something that has been in libraries for a very long time, but we have it in the standard now. So we could use templates in a better way. A template is just an HTML file. So if you need a lot of HTML to inject into your page, instead of injecting it like this, which could be good for like creating one list or something like that, but if you have a lot of code, you can add it to a template instead. So we could write this template in the head or in somewhere in the body close to where it should be injected. When the browser hits the template element, it will ignore everything that's inside of this. So when the page renders, it will just ignore all. So if there is an image loading, an image inside of this, it will not happen. This will be like a comment for the browser. It will just ignore it. But what we can do is we can find this template, the post template, and we can do something called import node to import the content of the template, and then we append the clone into the page. And when we do that, the browser will re-render the page with this P tag somewhere on the page where we need it. Yeah?
In the first assignment, I put the header and then some extra HTML class, but not in the template.
Yeah. You did it more or less this, but using jQuery.
Yeah, no, I had an actual HTML header code.
Hmm?
But I imported basically the header in one line in my HTML.
Yeah, you imported it using jQuery's built-in. So, yeah, that is probably using, because then you have that code is in a separate HTML file, or is it? Yeah, so then you're using like jQuery's template system for doing that. And I mean, you have templates, a lot of template engines, like Mustard, Handlebars and stuff. This way is the new standardized way that is built into the browser. But there's no wrong with using like jQuery or any other framework for loading templates. The important part is that you have separated, so the editor, if you open HTML code in the editor, you want the editor to know that this is HTML code, so you can like edit it and you get code completion and you get color coding and stuff. So if it's in a separate HTML file, or if it's like in this case in the same file but contained inside template tags, that's fine. We will probably look at both, because you can, when we come to Ajax later on, you could use Ajax to load templates from the server when you need them.
So then you can do it. You can have them in different files.
Yeah. So then you can have them in different files. You can have template files on the server that, if used, they will be requested by Ajax and rendered and put into the page. Yeah. In the first part of the course, we will just be enough with adding the templates inside of the HTML documents. This was quite cumbersome to do back in the days because you had to do like a script tag and you had to comment stuff away for the browser, but using the template tags, this is much easier. This one, true or false, is a deep copy or not. Often you want it to be true because you want to copy the whole element. If I had said false here, you would only have gotten the p tag, nothing else, or p element, nothing else. Okay, I think that's a break. Oh, it really is. So, great. We have covered the first part, and that's DOM, and there is really not much more to it. It's just manipulating objects, and by manipulating the elements on the page, you will be able to do pretty much whatever you like. Just with this knowledge, you could do like dragging and dropping. You could do stuff like if you click an image, it will go up in a light box. You could, everything like that you could do using manipulation like this. And the exercises for this part of the course will take you through all of those steps. So if you do the exercises, you will kind of be held in the hand through this process. But we want to land in this using templates for the rest of the course as much as possible. Okay, 10 minutes break. Okay, that was the DOM, and as I said before the lecture, I will not go into all details and show all examples. You have to read up in the book. However, to this lecture, there is a recorded demo as well that I recorded last year. It's a demo that I used to do on the lectures, but it's like over an hour long. So I've recorded that instead. In the demo, it's called Bartboard. In the demo, I show this stuff like cloning nodes and how to, as we will see, act upon events and using timers. So that demo is a recap of those two lectures. So I would say that it's mandatory to look at that demo after those two lectures, because they will tie everything up for you and show you a practical example of how to do stuff. So please have a look at that one. It's also one of the exercises. It's called Bartboard. So you're free, of course, to try to solve it for yourself first if you like, and then watch my recording, or you watch my recording first and you just read the code. You're completely free to do however you like around the exercises. But in that, the Bartboard, it's like if, yeah, the Bart, the or the Simpson series. In the intros, Bart is writing on the blackboard, right? Like, I should not do this and that. So the task for that example is to have blackboards on the page, and when you click the mouse on a blackboard, it will start writing letters, and when you stop or lift up the mouse button, it will stop writing, and you can click the next one, that will start writing, and so on. And to be able to do that, you need to be able to react upon user interaction. We can't just rely on timers or stuff like that. We need to be able to react on things that happen in the browser or that the user does. And this is what is called events. So some of you had programmed event-driven before. So for you, this will probably not be so much news. But for the rest of you, I just want to shortly explain how it works. So when you have written code up to now, we have written like a file, and that file has been run in a sequence. And when the program is ended, the program has stopped, and we need to rerun the program. And it runs from the top to the bottom, or depending on how the function calls are set up. So that's quite a synchronous way of looking at the code. When it comes to events and modern web applications, this is let's say it's a web application I've written. It's quite inspired by another application, maybe, that you recognize. So when you navigate on that, in that application, you will do things. You will like click this status message. You will click on the globe up where the notification is. So the user will interact with the page, and upon interaction, we need to do some action. So when the user clicks this globe, we need to have code that runs and presents something to the user. Okay, which new notifications do we have? Okay, so we need to fetch the notifications and we need to present them to the user. So we all the time our code needs to react on events happening in the browser. I usually draw a lot in this lecture, but I can't because we haven't gotten those Wacoms up and running. I will have to point in some way. But let's say we are clicking that notifications, then we have a function somewhere here in the middle of the code that we need to be run. So how do we do that? And that is what's called event-driven programming, to act upon things that happen. So I've divided this into three categories. You could divide those. You could see other classifications, but I think this is a simple one. We have user-initialized events, and this is like clicking with a mouse, writing with a keyboard, scrolling the window, resizing the browser window, interactions that the user is doing to our page or our application. We have the browser-initialized events. The browser can tell us, oh, the page is finished loading, or someone else changed the DOM, and things like that. The browser could tell us things like that. We also have timers. We can set a timer, and the browser will tell us, oh, time's up. You asked me to set a timer for 3 seconds. It's been 3 seconds. What do you want to do? So that is that kind of events that the browser is responsible for. And then we have, the network is a part of the browser, but I've divided it still. So we have some network events as well, so we can listen to and react when content gets loaded. So we could say that, okay, I need to fetch a template from the server, for instance. So go fetch the template, and then we will get a message when the template is fetched. It's no idea that we say that, okay, go fetch the template, and then we just wait and do nothing and freeze the application. Then we get template, then we present it to the user. It's better way is to just say, okay, go fetch that and tell me when you're ready. And I could start working with other stuff. The browser will continue, and somewhere down the line, an event will be triggered saying, oh, your content is ready. Oh, great. And then I could take the content and act upon it. So we have different kinds of events. This is an anti-pattern. I'm just showing you this because you will find code like this everywhere. You should not ever write code like this. What are we doing? Yeah, we are mixing JavaScript and HTML again, and this is even worse than before, actually. So you could write event code on the nodes itself inside of HTML. In this case, it's quite obvious what it does. We have an A element in the HTML code, and we have set the attribute onClick to do something. So this is obviously a function call. So we are calling the doSomething function because we have the parentheses. But this is enclosed in a string. So then we have the same problem as with inner HTML. This string sometimes comes from a variable or something and could maybe get injected code into it. So we have the security risk. And there are some performance issues with this as well, because this will have to run a parser, an extra parser, parsing the string and converting it to JavaScript that could be run. So you should never ever write code like this, but you will see it everywhere. So I'm just warning you, but don't do that, please. Where do we write our code? We write it into the JavaScript files, like this. So how do we add event listeners? Well, first of all, we need to find which element we should add and listener to. So say we want to find out when a user clicks a link, we want to act upon that. Then we need a way to find the link. In this case, I had an ID on the link. Maybe not ideal, but we had. So we get the A tag or A element. And then we use the add event listener method on this node. So we say A.addEventListener. The first argument to the addEventListener function is what event should we act upon? And here you have a lot of events. Click is quite obvious. When the mouse is clicked on the link, something will happen. You can have mouse down when the mouse is pressed, or mouse up when the mouse is released. Click is a down and a release. You can have double click. You could add a lot of different events, listen for different events on the A node. But this is something you need to look up in the documentation. Click you should know by heart, because that's probably the one you will use all the time. But there are others as well.
Yeah, the code in the output block, is that actually working? Because you initializing the function after you...
Yeah, that's a good point. Remember though, you could declare function in two ways. You could use it in a declarative way where you say that let button click equals function. Or you can use this notation where you say function button clicked. When you do it like this, the function is hoisted. So this will work, even though I have defined a function below this line. If, however, I had written let button clicked equals function, this would fail, because we will set undefined into the add event listener. So, but this is the next part. So we have set the click. We say that act upon click. And as the second argument, we are telling add event listener what to do when click, when the user clicks this link. And this is a notable. We are adding the reference. We are sending the reference to this function. We are not calling the function, no parentheses. We are just sending in the reference to this function, to the add event listener. So we are delegating to the browser, basically saying, okay, when someone clicks the A element, please run this code, and then we could just leave it. So when the user somewhere in the future clicks the link, the browser will call this function. And as an argument to the function, the browser will send some information about the click, like where the mouse pointer is located, which button the user used, if it was the left or the right, things like that. So we could use this parameter event to investigate what we got from the browser. And if you're doing dragging and dropping, you are quite interested in where the mouse pointer are when you are doing the dragging and dropping, for instance.
So the browser will make a call to that function?
Yeah. Or actually, the browser will tell the... I will say it like this. It might not be programmatically correct to 100%, but the browser will tell the A element to call this function. So if it will be that the A element is calling this function, and that is important, because if you're using this inside button clicked, this will refer to the A element.
What about then that button clicked event, we never use that?
Nope. This parameter will be filled with an argument when the A is calling this one.
Okay.
So that will be, the browser will inject that argument so that we will get some information. That's just to be able to get the information about which button you clicked or whatever. this is a simple way of doing it. You could do this in other ways as well, because we could do anonymous functions in JavaScript. So if we look at the next one, it's exactly the same, but instead of defining this function button clicked and adding the reference, we are just assigning an anonymous function inside of the add event listener. This is quite a usual way of doing it. And if you get that one, the next one should be just as simple, because we are just replacing this function with an arrow function call. So I talked briefly about arrow functions 2 weeks ago, and it's just another syntax of doing anonymous functions. And so in this case, we say that, and this is easier to learn, actually. So you're adding the event listener, click, comma, you get the event into this function and rerun the code. So that's event handling. You don't need to look too much about on this, but just remember that you are able to remove event listener. So if you set an event listener, you can always remove it. Could be something like you have been inactive, like a bank, and you're setting a timer for 15 minutes when the user isn't moving the mouse pointer, and after 15 minutes you will log out the user automatically. So when the user comes back and moves the mouse pointer, you want to reset or remove this timeout. Then you could do it with remove event listener. But when you're removing an event listener, you need the reference to the function that you gave the event listener in the first place. So if we are doing it in the two lower ways, we are not having a reference to the function, because those are anonymous functions, so we didn't save the reference, so we can't remove those event listeners. They will be there until they, forever, basically. But in this case, I'm using something called name function expressions. It's function expressions, but with the tweak that we are adding a name to this anonymous function, and then they are called named function expressions. So it's a named anonymous function.
Will that also be hoisted?
Will that also be hoisted? Good question. Don't think so. I do think so. I'm not sure. I haven't tried, but could be hoisted. Yes. So in this case, we are writing the anonymous function, but we are giving the anonymous function a name. And when we do that, inside of this function, we could reference the named function and we could remove it.
How is anonymous? We give it a name.
Yeah, it's not anonymous anymore. I wouldn't call this an anonymous function. It's called a named function expression. But it's like an anonymous function, but with a name. Sort of an anonymous function. Yeah, you can use that approach, of course. No problem. It's just that you save one line of code.
Yeah, but we repeat there.
Yeah. You are still naming it, so you could, I mean, this is probably a easier way of doing it. Yeah.
But if you want to remove it, you need to name it.
If you want to remove it, you need to name it. There is no other way. Not that I'm aware of, anyway. So if you're using the arrow functions, there is no way of removing it because it's unnamed. Okay, propagation. What is that? So, say that we are, and there is a pen. Okay, let's try this. I'm not sure it's working, but let's try. Whoa. Let's see what the code does first of all. No, don't look at the code. Look at the graph, the tree. So, in our case, say that we set an event down at the A tag. We fetch the tag and we set a click event on the tag. when the user clicks this element, stuff will start happening in the browser. And the browser will do something called event propagation. What it will do is that it will trigger, it will go through the node tree and see if there are events connected to this element or some of its parents. So it will go, first of all, it will start up here and it will look at the body and see, do we have any events connected to the body? No, okay. Then we will go to the div. Is there any events connected to the div? No. Then it will go to the P and it will continue down to the A. And this is called the capture phase. This is the first phase. And actually, when it comes to the A, it will notice that no, there are no events attached to the A yet. Because it will, after the capture phase, it will go the opposite way and it will look at the other side of the face. This is called the bubble. So the bubble face is on the other side. So this is the capture phase. And then it will start looking. Is there an event attached to the bubble face on the A tag? Yes, there is. We have set an event listener. And then it will execute that one. And then, or it won't execute it. It will put it in the queue, but I will get back to that. You can kind of see it as it executes that one. Then it will continue up the chain and look, is there anything on this one or this one or this one? So it will do a lot of checks on all the nodes and all the parent nodes using this capture phase and then on the other side, the bubble phase. So it's quite easy to remember which is the bubble if you have the tree like this because the bubbles bubble up, right? So capture is trickier. And you can, let's see, if you add a third argument to the add event listener, you can change the behavior if you want to be called on the capture or the bubble phase. So if you say true like that, you will sort of move it to the capture phase. So it will be set or triggered on the capture phase instead of the bubble phase. So if you don't specify anything, you will always get the call on the bubble phase. And often you don't need to think much about this. But what you need to think about is that you are able to stop if you catch the event here, you can stop it from bubbling further up. You can use this event.stop propagation. If you do that after down here, that's broke. You will just stop the rest of these phases to go on. That means that you could actually set an event for the capture phase on the body, and when the user clicks anything on the page, you could just say stop propagation, and all other click events will not work anymore. So you have a lot of power by using this event stop propagation. Did you get that? No, it's so fast. I mean, if you think about how many, there are so many events that happen in the browser all the time. Just me, if I mean, there is a lot of optimization as well, but just me re-dragging in the browser window will trigger so many events because it will, first of all, it will trigger re-render events because we are changing the size. It will trigger events for re-rendering the page all the time with a new CSS because you are changing the, the shape of the window. And there is a lot of things going on, and no, it probably, I mean, yeah, we will get to a performance issue soon, but as long as you just set an event or two, this will not be noticeable at all, because it's really fast.
But why we don't just set the event listener to a specific node,
yeah,
instead of just going all over?
Yeah, I mean, when you do this in practice, you will set the event to this listening on the bubble face, to the A tag, and then you will not even care about stop propagation. But in some cases, some edge cases, you don't want this behavior to, you don't want it to trigger other events further up in change if you do some kind of games maybe, or with some blocks flying around and stuff. So you can do that. I just want to show that you can do it. It's, you won't need to think about it that much. More than it's good to know that we have those phases and that all of those, yeah, that's important. All of those parent elements are checked as well. So instead of adding the event listener to the A tag, we could add it to the div and get the same functionality. And this is important in something called event delegation that I will come to soon. It's really important to know what triggered the event. So if we have a lot of list elements and the user clicks one of them, it's important for us to know which one did the user click, because we want to do something with that element and not all of them, for instance. So we can find out which element was clicked a number of ways. The first one and the easiest one in this code, okay, we get an A tag and we add an event listener for a click. We could just reference the A node, the variable A, because the inner function will have a closure to the outer function, so we will be able to get to the A node that way. And that's quite a simple way of doing it, just writing A dot do something with this one. Then we know which one it is. But as you see, this is also set to that node that triggered the event. And this is where it gets tricky, because if this code is inside of a type or a class, you would expect that this to reference the object of the class, right? Or the instance of the class. This is always inside of a class, that this should point to the instance of the class, right? But it does not in event listeners, because this will point to the element triggering the event. I will get to that in a moment. We also can use this event information we get using the target attribute. So event.target will give us the target clicked. This is also the last line is, of course, true as well. Hope you are all rested, because this is quite trippy to get your head around. If you understand this example, you have understand a lot about JavaScript. I would just try to explain it briefly. But, okay, closures, first of all, is that the inner function will have access to the outer function's scope and variables. So if you return a function from within a function, the return function will have access to the function that returned it and its parameters or variables. So say that we have a list like this with links. We have a div tag and we have four links inside of the div tag, and we want to add click events to all of them. Okay, we get all of the A tags and we use a simple for loop to just iterate over those four links. And for each iteration, we add an event listener to the A tags I. So we added an event listener to the first, the second, third, and fourth. And we added an event listener, we have the anonymous function, and the function will just log, click the link I, console log this text row, da, 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 da. The problem is, whatever link I click in this example, clicked link I, this one, this line, will always write 4. It should write 0, 1, 2, or 3, right? But it always writes 4. Why is that?
Because I, at the end of the loop, is set to 4.
Yeah, and that's because at the end of the loop, I is 4. So those functions will be able to get hold of the outer function's scope, whereas the I as well, so it could get a it will have a reference to the I's value, but those functions will be created in memory, and somewhere long gone in the future, say 10 seconds later, the user will click a link, and we will write what the value of I is, and in that case, this for loop has ended, and it ended on 4, so the value of I, when this function is called, will be 4, always. So this is a tricky part about closures, that inside a loop like this, it will always reference what the value was when the outer function returned. Yeah, this one will be called when clicked. The inner function will be called when clicked, yeah.
So how does it run already 4 times?
This code will run when we load a page. So the for loop will create 4 instances of this inner function.
Already?
Yeah. And then they will be, set those event listeners, and when the user eventually clicks one of the links, the code will be executed. But I will always point to the wrong I, or it will always point to 4. For all of those examples, I have a fiddle. Oh my God, what the show? How will I? I have so much to cover. But you can run those in the fiddle and just open the console, go here. Whoop. So when I, this is a fixed example. Damn it. Forget it. But you could, I thought it was shite. It wasn't that example. It was the one that worked, actually. Because I have an example where this is fixed. And this is fixed in this example. So instead of using the for loop, I am using the for each instead. And when using the for each, I will create another outer function that is connected to the inner function that is returned. So this inner function will get a closure to the outer function, which is an instance for each iteration in the loop, instead of one function for the whole loop, for all the 4 iterations. I think I will explain this in the memory demo on the exercises. So because this will get, you will need to do something like this when you're programming the memory exercise. And in my demo, I will explain this in greater detail. So have a look at that one. Because I don't have time. I have time for this. I must. So, if we back up to this one, I said that you could, instead of adding the event to this A down here, you could add an event listener to the one at top. Okay, so picture Minesweeper. You all know Microsoft game Minesweeper, right? So you have tiles. Say that you have 100 times 100, you have the big board, you have 10,000 tiles. Adding an event listener to each and every one of those tiles will make it super slow. So when you click, it will just, you will feel the application just overheating more or less. So that's not a good way of solving that problem. It's better to use something called delegates and delegation. So instead of adding the event listener to the specific mines, you add it to the board. So in this case, instead of adding event listeners for each and every link, we add the event listener to the div tag. So I get the div tag, I'm adding the event listener to the div tag, and then inside I could just investigate which element was clicked. And I do this by using the event.target. So event.target will give us the child lowest down in the tree that is clicked. So I will know which link was clicked in this case. And then I could work my way up if I need to. If those were enclosed in list elements, I want to get hold of the list element, I could just call parent node on the event.target to get to the parent. Yeah, we will just have a look at timers because they are important. Timers are special events in the browser that you can set to do things after a certain amount, certain time interval. So if we do it like this, set timeout, this is on the window object, so you could write window.setTimeout or just set timeout. Set timeout, and we add a function, and this function will be called by the browser after 3000 milliseconds. This is not a guaranteed time. This function will be called at 3000 milliseconds or later. Not earlier than 3000 milliseconds, but it could be called later, and that depends on what you have in the so-called event queue. So if a lot of events have stacked up that are running, this code could be put on hold and be activated in 3,200 milliseconds, for instance. There are APIs that you could use in the browser for doing exact time measurement. So you could start a timer, and then when this code executes, you could read the time and you could find out how many milliseconds has gone since you added the timer and until it ran, if it's really important to get those milliseconds right. Often it's like 3 seconds. Okay, so the user gets 3 seconds to answer a question or whatever. If it's 3,000 or 3,100 milliseconds, doesn't matter, and then we don't need to think about it. But in some case, edge cases, you might need to want to add add a second timer or something to just get the exact time. You can do intervals as well. This is a timeout. It will happen once. You can do intervals. They will happen with a certain interval. Those are a little bit dangerous because if you forget them and you don't remove them in some cases, they will just keep on triggering, like connecting to a server every third second because you forgot to remove this timer. And that will be costly. So be aware with the interval. You can clear them. You see the code here. I will not have time to explain it more. But timers are there. Use them. I will skip the event loop for now. I will start off with the event loop on the next lecture instead, because this we need to be really fresh in our minds to because this is important. In short, the event loop, I mean, JavaScript is single-threaded, as I said, so it will only run one code at a time. So if we add a lot of timeouts, for instance, and all of those timeouts trigger at once, they will be added in a queue, And JavaScript will just take the first in the queue and run the code, take the next one and the next one. And of course, if you have a timeout for, say, that, or an interval that runs every 10th millisecond, and the code inside takes more than 10 milliseconds, then you get the problem. So every 10th millisecond, the code will be added to the queue, but the execution of each block will take more than 10 milliseconds, then this queue will build. Often that's no problem because you're not doing stuff that often, but if you are, you will have a problem. But I will explain the queue in detail next week, and I will also tell you that we actually have more than one event queue in some cases, but for now we have one event queue. This is also described in the book, I hope. Yeah, so there was a lot to cover today. I think it's when speaking English, I'm slower. So if you who speak Swedish, you can watch the last year's Swedish lecture, and I actually made it through in that one. I'm not sure why, but okay. Next week, one lesson, and then the peer instruction on the afternoon. I urge you all to come to the peer instruction. That is important. Okay? Bye.